Welcome to More Than Miles, the podcast where we use storytelling and expert interviews to widen the lens on what it means to be a happy and healthy endurance athlete. We believe that athletes are so much more than their body, sport, and training miles. I'm Dr. Kate Mihivik-Edwards.
And I'm Dr. Casey Sinders. We are endurance athletes, physical therapists, and huge coffee addicts. We spend most of our time treating, educating, and working with endurance athletes. Thank you so much for tuning in today. Now let's get to the show.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to More Than Miles. Today, we are going to have an episode that both Casey and I are very excited about. It's a little bit silly, and it's definitely different than what we typically do. But Casey and I have had a lot of discussions where we break out in hysterical laughter from the time that we've known each other all the way up to now. But lately, there have been a couple topics, including different words that are happening in the running culture that maybe one or both of us have no idea what people are talking about because we're getting old, or some of the new trends in 2022 that we're reading about in various articles. And then also just some things that are coming up in conversations on the run. So this episode will be a bit different, but we think it'll be a lot of fun. Hi, Casey.
Hi, Kate. I am so excited that this is finally happening. We've been talking about this for, I think, a couple of months now. And this came about because I was scrolling Instagram one day and there was a word that was coming up very frequently. And granted, most of these accounts were people younger than myself, and I did not know what it meant. So I looked it up on Urban Dictionary, as one does.
Of course.
Just a black hole of, I don't know, but it gets you the information you want most of the time. So I look up this word, this phrase on Urban Dictionary so that I could understand these Instagram posts. And I'm like, oh no, it's happening. I'm getting old.
I love Urban Dictionary, but what I love most about this conversation, it's the first time you're jumping up into my category. Usually you always know what everyone is talking about, what they're saying, but now you're finally seeing runners that are just young enough that they're saying things that you don't understand. And it brought great joy to me when you didn't know the word.
I'm here to bring you joy, Kate. But it was happening to me when I was treating a bunch of high school runners, and I was like, listen, like, you need to educate me. What does this mean? And they thought that was funny and really got joy out of that. So I will share the word or phrase that it was.
And we're just going to jump into the words that we've been hearing in running culture lately that we didn't know. Some of them, Casey has actually made a list, just so that you all know, of words that I have not had, that I've not been privy to. And she's going to bring them up. And apparently I'm going to guess what they mean, and then we'll find out what they really mean. But I also want to know what Casey's guess is so that I'm not left out here as the, you know, really old person.
Yes, I'll join you in solidarity here. Okay. The word was drip.
So when she said that people were using the word drip on Instagram, I immediately thought of urinary incontinence, just so everybody knows, which is really not what it means at all. Because, you know, of our background and because I've had a baby and I talk about postpartum runners all the time. So Casey, what did you think the drip meant?
Okay. So the Instagram post I was looking at, they were talking about what they were wearing. I was like, why does this have anything to do with what they're wearing? Like, how is this a fashion descriptor? And turns out it is. So
what's the definition?
Yeah. So if you... I don't know if I can do this without laughing. So if you Urban Dictionary drip, it says adjective to describe your outfit, similar to swag, sauce, steez, or swank.
So how would you use the drip in a sentence?
So here's our, oh my God. Or secondary definition, just another word for immense swag. Yo, that rapper got the drip.
Okay, well, that's interesting. But you still haven't answered what you thought it was.
I just thought it was really out of place. I was like, how does this describe, like, where does this fit into this Instagram post? I thought it had something to do with, like, I don't know, the drip of, yeah, I don't know what I thought it meant. I did not think of urinary incontinence, so I will say that.
Fair enough. Okay, well, so that was a lovely was a lovely word or word choice that really sparked this entire episode. But why don't you give us some others that have come up lately in conversation with our athletes or on Instagram, whatever, in our running culture that we should bring up?
So a favorite of mine, chunky boys.
I'm sorry, say that again.
Chonky boys.
Chonky
boys. Two words. Chonky. C-H-O-N-K-Y. And then boys. Could be spelled like boys, like B-O-Y-S or B-O-I-S.
B-O-I-S? Chonky boys? I've definitely never heard that one. Okay. So chonky boys, what does that make me think of? I mean, I don't even know. Guys, I was not prepared for this. Just so you know, this is the first time hearing this phrase. I mean, I actually think of like big shoes, like chunky shoes. So
ding, ding.
Oh my God, I'm right.
Yes. So this
is amazing.
So this is a term that a lot of people are describing with the carbon plated shoes that have gotten a really big stack height because they are chunky.
Or otherwise known as chunky.
Yes, but no. Chunky and chunky are, you know, there's some nuances there.
I'm going to use chunky tonight and when I'm talking to my husband and see if he knows what I'm talking about. And I'm going to be really, really, really awesome. And he's going to wonder what happened to me today.
Oh my God, this is amazing.
Chunky boys. Okay. All right. I like it.
Yeah. So, you know, particularly like the alpha flies that are like really big.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we call those chonky boys.
Oh, we call them chonky boys. So now you've been using that term.
Oh, no. <Mm-mm>.
Okay. But the running community outside of us who are younger and much cooler, but cool is probably not a word anymore. So that's great. Okay. Go on.
So this one isn't exactly running specific, but what do you think of when someone says slaps? Like, the song really slaps.
That's how you would use it. This song really slaps.
It's an adjective. So
this song really slap. I mean, like makes you want to dance.
I mean, basically. So yeah,
God, it's like, I'm so good at this.
You are so good at this. Let's Urban Dictionary this and see what it says.
Okay. So use this word again. So that song is so slaps. Is that the right way that we would say it?
Oh yes. So here, yeah. So it says it actually is specific to music according to Urban Dictionary.
Yes.
And it says music that is desirable. So formal. I cannot get over how formal. Music that is desirable.
Okay. Thank you, Urban Dictionary. We should probably tag you and hopefully you'll want to sponsor us. We're just going to start calling out all these people to sponsor us. Okay, great. All right. So this music slaps. I bet my son, my 7-year-old son, knows that.
Only one way to find out.
I'm going to ask him tonight. Okay, go ahead.
The next one is one that I had to ask my high school patients about. And I still don't fully understand it, okay. But it is the word yeet.
Oh, I've heard this one before. Yeet. But I don't remember who was saying it. I think I was just laughing. Use it in a sentence.
Let's see. Alex finishes his soda and proceeds to yeet his empty can into a trash bin.
Oh, like toss
Alex,
it?
Alex, while throwing the can. Yeet!
You should have put your name in that. Okay. So, throwing the can or, throwing the can with excitement, throwing something with excitement.
Pretty good. So discard an item at high velocity.
Okay. So yeet.
Yes.
I was throwing a ball, you guys. Like,
yeah. Actual. Yeah. Okay. She's all right. Throwing the ball motion.
So we're going to have to make a list of these in our show notes with the definitions. And I'm going to start using them randomly within the clinic and see who knows what I'm talking about. It's going to be really great.
Okay.
Yeah. Keep
Very
going.
Excited
Any more?
So one, I think this was kind of coined, this has been like used, I think, in more like action sports, but it's kind of bled into the running sport, but this idea of sending it or full send, Kate has a very blank expression.
So because I'm thinking about email, use it in a sentence.
So
instead of full stop, it's full send.
Full send. Let's see, in a sentence. Last weekend when I raced, I sent it and went out too fast.
Oh, it's like biting it, like going out too fast and exploding, like not being able to finish the race. What's the word I'm looking for that I would use? That's really bad. I'm like biting the dust. That's really old school. But what does it mean?
Again, according to Urban Dictionary. Knowingly and willfully pursuing a high-risk course of action with reckless disregard for potential consequences.
Oh, so that's like when Brian and I used to run together and he would go out too fast and I'd say, don't go out too fast, Brian, because if this is the pace you want to hold, we're going to keep it the whole way, even if it's 17 miles. And then we would go and he would do it anyway. And then I'd just leave him in the dust and then he'd be coming home like 30 minutes later and I'd be sitting out on the front porch drinking something.
Yes. So Brian sent it and
he sent it.
It hurt.
And it hurt. Got it.
Yeah, I think Molly Seidel has been, she calls like her brand of racing, like full send racing, like just going for it, you know?
Going for it. That would
yeah,
be
kind of like going for it essentially. Yeah.
Full send. I was thinking full stop, like the end of a sentence.
Opposite.
Okay, good. That's great. Anymore?
I think that's it.
I would definitely like our listeners to send us more words and more phrases in the running culture that we might be missing, because there's got to be many. And it could be really fun if we get enough, we could do one at the beginning of an episode on a regular basis or periodically, depending on how many there are. But yeah, that's pretty cool. All right. Well, that's funny. Those are definitely phrases that I hadn't heard. The yeet. Is it yeet?
Yeet.
I've heard that before, but I definitely didn't know what it meant. So
it has multiple meanings and I'm still kind of confused. It means to like chuck something, like it means to like throw something.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Yeet it is. I hope this episode is full send.
I
don't think that worked.
We're really sending it on this episode.
We're really sending it on this episode with the silliness. Okay. All right. So those are our words, interesting enough, but let's go ahead and talk about some of what we've seen for the 2022 trends this year. I've read some pretty funny articles. The first one I would like to talk about is weighted hula hooping.
Which, funny enough, considering that this is a trend, I've never heard of this, but I also Googled it and was looking up, and apparently this weighted hula hoop is $95 regular price, but it's on sale for $65 right now. So if you guys are really yearning for the weighted hula hoop functional training, it's on sale. So now would be the time.
$95 is a lot for a hula hoop. I think they're like $10. Usually.
Yeah, like this is what you get at Walmart and you like beg your mom to get a new hula hoop. Like it's yeah, not even $10.
So I think weighted hula hooping, there were a couple articles, and there was an article that said there was a research publication in the Journal of Strength and Conditioning that advocated for weighted hula hoop training for ab strength. I didn't read the article yet, so I'm going to read it. But I think that's part of why this trend is on an uptick. But I haven't actually seen anybody hula hooping. Have you seen anybody hula hooping?
No, Absolutely not. Especially not our runners. I mean, our hips do not go that way.
Maybe we should have a weighted hula hooping contest. That would be for all of our runners.
That would be great. That would be awesome. And like bonus points for like good video footage.
Tag us in your awesome weighted hula hoop exercise training. That's interesting.
Yeah. I mean, so this weighted hula hoop, right? So it, like not only is the ring portion of the hula hoop somewhat weighted, but there's like this weight attached to it that kind of swings. So it kind of reminds me of that, like kettlebell, the idea of kettlebells where like there's momentum involved.
Or what about the ab thing that people used to put around their waist that vibrated?
Oh my God, no. Yes. And yeah, it vibrated. And then weren't there some that do like e-stim? Like they said that it stimulated your abs. And so you could get a six pack while sitting on your couch.
Yeah, that was awesome. If that actually worked, we'd all have a six pack.
I know, right? Like,
I mean, I know that it sounds like we're bashing weighted hula hoop training because we kind of are, but neither of us have tried it. So maybe we have to try it and then maybe we're wrong. It's true. We haven't done enough research.
We are discussing it. We are not judging anyone. And they're like, if you're getting into fitness and you're doing something like good for you, I'm like super proud of you for doing that. So, yeah, no judgment here.
But. Yeah. No judgment. It's just very interesting. And I think also runners are purists in a lot of ways. So, it just seems strange, but you know what? I hope that I see some people doing it soon. And then I might try to borrow their hula hoop because I'm not paying $95 for a hula hoop that I never use.
Right. Yeah.
Although who knows if I start doing it, I promise to put it on my Instagram.
Okay. Sounds like a deal. Okay. If we get this many followers on the podcast, Kate will post a video of her weighted hula hooping.
Oh God. Some of the other trends, well, actually one of the trends from 2021 were Peloton and wild swimming. I would just like to mention that was in an article I read. I'm not sure what wild swimming means. Do you know what that means?
I do not know what that means. I just like picture someone doing like Tarzan swim, like the swimming drill where you keep your head above water. Like, you know, like what little kids do, like
going
back and forth. Like, that's what I picture when I think of wild swimming.
That'd be interesting to see, but I guess we're past that now. Peloton is still, obviously doing very well, but it was a huge trend last year in virtual coaching and virtual exercise classes. But now that, everything is kind of being lifted, people are going back to the gym and staying outside and going to races, which is so cool. I'm really, really glad that that's starting to happen. And we're kind of returning to hopefully a better fitness world, because some of the other things that we did read and we were looking at, we're talking about how people are looking at themselves a little bit more holistically, which is great. And I think that's a really good trend in the right direction.
We were reading too, defining athletic success differently, and the value of an athlete differently, in terms of sponsorship and, inspirational value to, you know, people as a whole and things like that.
That's like my whole soapbox about changing how we look at people and how we look at athletes and what they're contributing outside just of what they're doing with their physical body, but like who they are. And, I think it's really incredible that that's been changing.
Yeah. And I think we have, you know, athletes who are finally putting their foot down to kind of think for that, you know, if we're looking at like Simone Biles and all of the sort of boundaries that some of the professional athletes have started to set. And I'm a huge fan of it.
Oh yeah. Because if we can get our professional athletes to do it, hopefully it'll come down the chain and start happening with our collegiate runners and our high school and middle school runners. And I wish that we could go up the chain and start them when they're young so that they never end up, you know, in trouble. But yeah, I think it's a great trend.
And kind of going back to Peloton has I mean, a ton of workout classes now. It's not only cycling, like they have all of these like really short strength workouts. Like they have the strength for runners workout and like bar and Pilates and just all of these like things that can be easily done at home. And a lot of them are 10 or 15 minutes, which I actually really like. I don't have a problem with this at all. Meaning? But as long as my patients also do the exercises I gave them, I really like them. And I think it makes it digestible for some people. Cause if it's like a 15 minute class, they're like, oh, I have 15 minutes. I can do that. And, I always tell people the best strength training is the strength training you actually do. The best program in the world doesn't mean anything unless you do it. So true. Anything that can get people to start, I'm a fan of.
I love that too. And it's funny because, you know, our Georgia boy on Peloton, Matt Wilpers, it's so funny because I actually used to run a race with him every year. He was good friends with my friend Haley, and that's how I got to know him. I met him at a bunch of different races when I first moved to Atlanta. And then he used to do Reach the Beach relay with us. So he was on our team, which was a relay from the mountains to the water up in New Hampshire. It was a lot of fun. And it was a 24-hour race. And we were in these vans and we ate just like disgusting peanut butter and honey sandwiches and trail mix and didn't really sleep. And I mean, it was amazing, but he was on my team for that for a few years and he's a lot of fun. So every time I see his face, I saw his face in the Peloton team's face when I was on Delta the other day, because they're even doing like short meditations and things for the plane, which is really cool.
Yeah. Awesome.
Yeah. But I always kind of laugh when I see it because he's such a nice guy. Like he seems like a nice guy on Peloton, but he's actually a really great guy. You don't always see. So my shout out to Matt.
Hi, Matt.
Hi, Matt. I don't think he listens to our podcast, but if he did,
he might
that
now.
That would be his shout out. Okay. So going on for some of the other trends that we saw, one of the other things that we saw as a trend, oh wait, I have to bring up one more point about the weighted hula hooping, just because I'm obsessed with it now.
Yeah, let's go back to that for sure.
It was an increase by 234% from 2021 to 2022. So it's an incredible fad. Like it's really picking up steam right now.
Okay. So now 24 people are doing it instead of
zero. Oh, stop. Whatever. There's a lot of articles about it. So it's got to be more than 24 people. okay, moving on. So reverse running, which we like to call running backwards, is also a new trend happening.
Yeah, which I think is interesting. I mean, I have seen a handful of people running backwards. I would not say it's a trend that I've noticed. I do, you know, I don't know. I'm not going to advocate for it, but it encourages a different muscle activation pattern. Mm-hmm. It definitely makes you use your posterior chain and glutes a little bit more. It can train posture, I think was one of the reasons that the article we read gave for reverse running or backwards running. I don't know how, like the big key though is to look behind you so that you don't fall or run into anything as you're backwards running.
Yeah. So we can't really prevent injuries if it's just because you've run into something. As physical therapists and medical providers, it's very hard to help prevent an injury that is just you running backwards without looking. So you've got to look.
Right.
But yeah, I do think there are benefits to backwards running. I mean, I really do. I like the argument of helping with posture and activating posterior chain. I mean, we were taught in PT school to walk backwards on a treadmill to help activate the posterior chain and hamstrings. So I don't necessarily think it's a bad thing. It's just something interesting that I didn't realize would become a trend. Like the other thing I'm wondering, like what makes a trend, right? How many people does it have to excite to become a trend?
That's a great philosophical question there, Kate.
I'm just wondering, but yeah, so reverse running or backwards running, as we would call it, is a 2022 trend. And again, it seems silly since it's our silly podcast today. It seems silly, but maybe it does have some benefits and, just turn around and look so you don't get hurt. Maybe do it in an empty field.
Could be good. Or stick to a track. Maybe.
I don't know. The track turns. It's a circle.
Oh, does it really? I had no idea.
So you want to make sure that you're in the straightaways. I guess you wouldn't. I mean, I wonder how long you run backwards in this new trend. How do we?
The thing, I was thinking, like, I wouldn't want to do it more than 400 meters at a time.
How would we use backwards training? That's what I'm wondering. Would you use it as a warm up? Would you use it as a cool down? Would you use it as strength and mobility? Or how would you use it?
Probably a warm up and cool down, or probably cool down because you're warm and you're ready to use kind of your whole system.
Like a training tool, right? Yeah. And you don't want to do it too early because of those hamstrings.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
That's right.
No, so that's how I would probably use it, or like a running drill sort of that you do post run.
Yeah. Okay. Interesting. I wonder how many, I'd like to hear if any of our runners are doing some of these trends. So this is our episode where if you're listening, shoot us a message. Let us know either on our Instagram or shoot us a message in our email. And what is our email, Casey?
morethanmiles12@gmail.com.
Yeah. So that we can start learning about some of this stuff. We do treat runners every single day, and Casey runs every single day, almost except for the days she's on break, but with people. So we're around runners all the time, but we still don't know all of this. So it's really cool to do some research and see kind of what's out there.
Yeah.
Other parts of the country for sure. So this one is going to be good because Casey's going to probably explode when she starts talking about this. I can't wait. But let's talk about readiness score.
Oh my gosh.
Good what stuff. What is readiness score, Casey?
Readiness score. So
people don't know.
This is a calculation that is made by a lot of these physiological trackers. So Whoop or
Garmin.
The Aura ring. The Aura ring. I almost said, you do not want to know what I almost just said. Yeah, different kind of not. Ring. Okay. So
moving on. Go ahead.
Moving on. And so it uses a variety of physiological markers. So this could be body temperature, this could be heart rate variability. This could be just like tracking your activity over the day. But the point of readiness score is there's so many things that go into it, and we don't really know. A lot of these devices aren't explicit into what measures they're putting together to give you this score.
Or algorithms.
There's some sort of algorithm. And, you know, I think these devices are really good, but I don't know if they're quite that good. And so they give you basically a readiness score that tells you like, hey, you should take it easy today. Or, yep, you're green, good to go, do a hard workout, you know, whatever you had planned today, and so on and so forth. Yes, the part that bothers me is the algorithm aspect of this, because we don't really know where it gets that score, and it doesn't know about your life and your training. And so I think, you know, staying in tune with your body and, you know, considering everything that you have going on from a stress perspective, I think is more than enough. You don't really need a device to tell you that. What I will really explode on is Garmin's productive and unproductive algorithm or whatever they use. I am very happy that my watch doesn't do that. But there are several watches out there that you will finish a workout and it tells you if your training that day was productive or unproductive. And then it will tell you if you're detraining or losing fitness, essentially, which rude. I'm out here working hard. Okay. You cannot tell me that my workout was unproductive.
You don't know me.
You don't know me. You don't know about my life. But, the biggest issue with this, right, is that a lot of the, I assume that a lot of the algorithm that Garmin uses is based off of the heart rate data that it gets from, a daily basis and during workouts, and the optical wrist-based heart rate is horribly inaccurate. And so you can't use that really poor data to make a judgment on someone's workout. Can you feel the passion in my voice?
I can feel the rage actually. And I can see it in your face. I wish everyone else could. So I'm in agreement with you about the readiness score, but what I want to clear up here are a couple things. I think in the last, since COVID hit, since 2020, our society has become more reliant on technology because it had to. And so a lot of different things came out of that. And we also have been more focused on our health and our wellness. So a lot of companies are really tackling that and trying to tackle that and help people so that they can learn to recognize patterns in their body better. And we know that runners in general and athletes in general aren't that great about looking at the signs and listening to their body so that they don't get injured or prevent injury or, you know, stay healthy. A lot of us overtrain and we don't even realize that we're overtraining. So I wanted to say that. So I think that a lot of this comes with good intention, but it's just not in a place that we can really rely on it. And I think, again, we put so much into, we rely so much on our technology that we take what our Garmin says and as the word, right? So if it says
the gospel of the Garmin,
right? So whatever it says, we're like, oh, well, I can't train today. Or, you know, we might just take our Garmin off and train anyway, depending on your personality. I would throw the Garmin watch across the room and probably go out, but that's just me. I think that we should be aware of that. The other thing that I think we need to be aware of is that it's not helpful and it doesn't help with stress to obsess about what your readiness score is. So part of everything that we talk about or a lot that we know is that stress is stress. And so even if you're starting to get stressed out about the numbers that you're receiving and the messages you're receiving on your watch, that's not helpful and it's making it worse. And another thing is heart rate variability is not readiness score. I have to say this because we've talked about heart rate variability a lot. And I do think heart rate variability is a great tool to see and look into your nervous system and see how your body is recovering. And it is not the same thing as the readiness score. So where we might be saying, okay, readiness score isn't exactly where we need it to be or want it to be. And maybe it is not as good of an indicator to determine how we should work out. Heart rate variability is a great tool that we can use to take into consideration when we're planning workouts. The other thing is all of this data that we're getting, you have to look at individually and you have to look at it over time to see what your trend in your body is. So perhaps you live at a different number or you live in a different space than someone else and your function and how you feel, your number could look very, very different. So we can't compare ourselves and our numbers to somebody else's.
Yes. Thank you for taking my emotional blindness out of this conversation. I like that you bring up the obsession with the numbers because this is actually, because I've been going back and forth on getting an Oura ring actually for a while because I feel like it has, neither here nor there, but I think it would be better for me and my purposes versus some of the other devices out there. And I'm very, two things. I'm worried it's going to tell me things that I don't want to hear.
It does.
Yep. And then the second is that, I'll get mentally kind of bogged down by it, especially if it's like a race week and like all my numbers are crappy or whatever. That is definitely a worry of mine. Even though I think all that data is really, really great to have.
So I have an Oura ring and I have a love-hate relationship with it. I won't wear it for weeks and then I'll start wearing it. And when I do, I totally obsess about it. And so I have an obsessive compulsive behavior type A, and it's really can get the best of me if I'm not careful. So
yes, I try so hard to accommodate her OCD behaviors.
What?
And I still can't do it.
Are you kidding?
No.
Like, wait, okay. I'd like examples. Now we're going down a totally different path. Unplanned warning. Go ahead.
When we used to share a treatment room.
Oh God, that was the worst. You're so messy.
See, exactly. And she's saying that despite my efforts to try to put everything back in its place and where it should be, I really did try.
I know you did.
I think I did. You're not.
I know like you me. Tried. I know you tried. I just didn't think it worked out.
Yes. Like when, I try to keep the Serenbe office as clean as I possibly can, but I took extra measures to do like a full clean when Kate came back from South Africa last week. and she still walks in and changes everything. So I really do try.
I'm so sorry that you're upset about it. I can't help myself. I see things out of order and I can't settle down. And this is so much better than in my 20s. In my 20s, it was intolerable. Like people couldn't be around. Like no one could even go in my bedroom. My closet was organized by color and like sleeve length. I remember my college roommates taking me and it got worse. So it's interesting because the more I ran, the more obsessive I became. And my college roommates, I lived with them after college. They took me aside one day and said, you know, this is really unhealthy and you can't live like this. And you really need to chill out and not be so obsessive compulsive. And I got really mad at them and didn't listen. But later in life, I started to be better and I feel like I'm a lot better, but yeah, it's hard. It's struggle on me because I know that nobody can like keep everything in order. So it's same thing happens in my house. Even my son tells my husband now that he's not picking up correctly and things aren't in the right place because he's heard me say it so long, but I know it happens at work and I'm sorry.
Well, I just want you to know that I try and I think about it and I try to accommodate and, because of who I am as a person, it's not always going to be to your satisfaction.
It's okay. We couldn't be more opposite in that kind of spectrum, which is really funny because sometimes I walk in your room when you're not there and I clean it up. I try really hard not to, but like the little plastic things from the dry needle or from the needles, I find them on the floor everywhere. And I just go on the floor on my hands and my knees and I pick up all the needle, like the plastic things. And then I roll up your, like wires on your desk sometimes and just, you know, set them aside so they're not all over the place. And then the books on the shelf, I do put them.
Oh my God.
It's true. Okay. So now apparently this podcast has turned into confessional hour.
we're discussing our differences.
Oh boy. I didn't know that it was going this way. I mean, I thought we were talking about readiness score in HRV.
No, this is just a window into our lives.
A window into our lives. Oh man. Okay. Well, I'm not sure where to go after this.
We have strayed quite offshore.
Yes, we have.
What haven't we talked about? Because you have your sunglasses on today, let's talk about cool sunglasses.
Oh, cool sunglasses. So, well, we love Gooder, of course, which we've talked about before in the past, because I like how inexpensive they are, how they don't move on your face, and how they have all the different types, shapes and colors, and they have the best names of sunglasses.
They do. I have, last count, I think I have 12 pairs.
Wow. And Ollie hasn't eaten any?
Yes, Ollie has eaten two. And that was really upsetting for me.
My dog's going to be eaten six pairs.
Six pairs? Oh my God.
Six pairs of Gooder sunglasses. Yes. And then I found that my husband was wearing a pair of mine and they were one of the girly colors and it made me laugh really hard because he couldn't find his black ones or the dogs had eaten them. I'm not sure. But yes, different sunglasses. So I like this new trend of sunglasses and it's been going on actually for several years. But of just finding sunglasses that actually work from a functional perspective that aren't too expensive. Because I remember years ago, back in my day, sunglasses were really expensive. And they really didn't look great either.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a thing, called emotional support sunglasses. And it's this thing that I do when I get sad and I buy a new pair of sunglasses and they're usually Gooders because they're not super expensive. So if you see me sporting some new Gooders, you should probably ask me how I am.
That goes out to everybody, please. Oh, that's interesting. I wanted to also circle back around tracking and technology for just a moment. So one of the things that I've always struggled with as a runner was obviously my obsession. So my obsession and my kind of OCD and type A personality of wanting to look at numbers and wanting to see how I can push myself and what was happening in my body. But then I went through a period of time where I stopped tracking everything and I found that I actually got faster. Have you ever done that?
Sort of in the middle, right? Like I don't look at my watch while I'm running. I always look after. So I don't really get too much feedback during the run. So like, and even with workouts, I'll try not to look at my watch and go by feel. And, but I've never, I admit it gives me an immense anxiety to think of leaving my house for a run without my Garmin watch.
Doesn't count if it hasn't been tracked, right?
Yeah. It just, it doesn't count if it's not on Strava. It never happened.
Yeah. I know it creates anxiety, but what is that about? So what is that about? Why do we have to do that as runners?
You know, I think that's a great question. I think some of it is like, it's like validation for our effort. So if you have something to show for it, like something tracked that we ran and, you know, it's a little bit bonus points when it goes on to Strava and other people saw that we ran that day. So I think some of it is validation. I think some of it is, yeah, just this kind of OCD sort of data obsession that we want to have everything tracked so that we can look at our miles during the week and know what pace we ran and how far and all of this stuff. Yeah. I don't know. You know, like most things, I'm sure there's some sort of insecurity at the root of it.
So I think that we should challenge our listeners to try and run maybe once a week without a watch, because I think it could actually be a great mindfulness exercise. In it could start, you know, right now we're talking about how we're obsessed with data. We're always looking at it. And I'm thinking about what kind of stress does that cause? Of course I am. And I'm thinking, you know, if we want to downregulate our nervous system and we want to have more balance and become, you know, a better athlete overall and be able to adjust to different circumstances, perhaps we, you know, make it part of our training to drop the watch or drop the device or whatever it is once a week so that we can think about our breathing, think about how it feels when our foot hits the ground, think about, you know, what smells do we smell? What sounds do we hear? You know, and that same day that you don't have a watch, if you're a runner that runs with music, maybe you drop the music so you can really be in that run in that moment and try to do it more mindfully so we can tap into the other side of the brain.
Yeah. You know,
I knew. Okay. So Casey just represented 99.9 of all runners out there. Yeah. I don't think I'll do that.
I just don't see how not running, like just because I have my watch on doesn't mean I'm not mindful of my environment and I'm enjoying the sunrise or the sound of the birds or the smells of Publix baking bread in the morning, or, you know, like, I don't think my watch detracts from that. I do think music does, which is why I don't always run with music or a podcast. That's something that I only use on like kind of more dire situations or if I'm really having a hard time getting out of bed. But I feel like I can still be mindful with my watch on.
You might be able to, but it doesn't mean everyone can.
It's true.
So maybe you can, or maybe you might do an experiment and take it off and see if your experience is different.
Then how's my coach going to know that I did my run?
You could tell your coach and she can take your word for it. I mean, that's strange.
That is weird. I don't know about that.
All right. Well, it's just a suggestion. And like I said, 99.9% of everybody listening to this will be giving me the same reaction that you just had. And I'm just saying it might be worth it if we continue to talk about, you know, what athletes need and how do we become better athletes and how do we get out of this whole just in our physical body kind of thing. You know, one way, it's a really easy way, is maybe dropping some of that technology once a week. Becoming more mindful.
I don't disagree. But I'd like to brag on myself for a second, which I never do.
Okay.
I feel like I'm in a good place with running right now. And, you know, not everyone can say that. And I definitely feel for people who are struggling with it or with injuries and things like that. But I feel really like running is so easy for me to love right now. I don't really feel a need to change anything that I'm doing.
Oh my God. You're like my case study. So, okay.
Oh my, whoa. So
jeez,
look,
Kate.
So look, okay. You can't just be happy for me.
I'm really happy for you. You know I am.
Okay.
You know I am.
Okay.
But you're just exactly the person I've been thinking about lately, in that when someone is feeling really good and in a good place, they can't see if there's something else going on. And we talked about this earlier with Gate. It's the same thing. Like, just because you're in a good place, and I'm not trying to mess with you, because I'm so happy that you're in a good place. I'm really not trying to mess with you, but I actually had this, I was having this long discussion yesterday, and I was really thinking about, you know, our athletes and how can we make them better and how can we prevent injury and how can we kind of, get them to recognize that, just because they're in a good place doesn't mean there aren't things that can make them make it better. And you just happened to say that. So it really brought it to my attention.
Well, I'm going to defend myself a second, because I have made a lot of changes in the past 2 years to get here.
Oh yeah. I think it's been great.
So I think that's why it's because I took a hard look at it and changed things that I had been doing for a long time, and finally did things that I've been putting off for a long time. And I'm able to say that because I have been changing things and trying new things.
No, and I think
and
it's
I've been
great.
Really big on the quote unquote little things, which I always like to say that they're actually the big things. So, you know, strength training, taking care of your body, sleep, nutrition, all those things. I've made a lot of changes in those departments and continue to do so. The reason why I feel in a good place is because I feel open to those things.
Yeah, all of those things are great. And I agree with you. And I'm not taking anything away from the journey that you have been on. And I do think that you're making and have made a lot of good changes. I just also sit in this idea, there's always room for improvement, and we never stop growing. You can't get to where you are without making the changes that you've made, but you can't continue to grow and continue to get better and healthier unless you're open to making other changes. And so you can be in any stage and sit and be happy. And that's lovely. And I'm grateful that you're in that spot, but it doesn't mean that there's not more out there. That's all. It just, you know, you're somewhere on that continuum and you're in a happy place, and it's amazing.
This is all because I'm not meditating yet, isn't it? You're still bitter.
I'm not bitter. Meditators don't get bitter. I'm just kidding. I'm totally kidding. They do.
So zen.
I'm not very zen. No, I just think that there's other places. I'm not saying even for you, but for a lot of runners, this discussion is, a lot of runners feel the way that you feel and get to where you get. And it's looking at nutrition, looking at strength, looking at sleep, looking at all of those factors are incredibly important, incredibly important. And we have to do that. And I think it's huge to even get there, but that's not everything. That's still all in your physical body. That's not all the other stuff. And you've been working on other things besides those. So I don't want to say that you haven't, mm-hmm. because you absolutely have, like the mental and emotional health and well-being of yourself. And that's a lot of the other component. But I think that we all have to keep growing. I'm still working on a ton of stuff outside of running and who I am, and trying to figure out where I'm going. We just can't stop growing. And we can't stop in one place. And you can definitely stop and have a victory run and a victory lap and enjoy it, as you should, but there's always more.
That's true.
I'm sorry that you got defensive and that it went the wrong way. I'm just okay. Simply saying that there's
it's
so
a good reminder. It's a good reminder that should still be looking for ways to improve and to keep learning and growing.
Yeah. And yeah, meditation is something I think everyone should do, but I know that everyone's not going to do it. You know what I mean? There's that. So that's whoever's choice. And no matter what we say, no matter what the benefits are, it doesn't matter until somebody's ready. So no, I'm not bitter that you're not meditating, but you're just not in that place where it's working for you right now. I'll always tell you the benefits because I think that someday you will be ready to do it. But it doesn't mean that you're not going to be a good runner, and it doesn't mean that you're not going to be happy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh boy, that was our first public fight.
It was.
I think it was.
Thank you all for joining us.
Just, you know, we'd be hugging if we were in the same room by now.
Oh, yes, we would.
I love you, Casey.
I love you, Kate.
Well, I think on that philosophical discussion, we should probably end this episode.
Yeah, I mean, I think we covered a lot of really good ground. I think it had a good combination of like lightness and brevity and hilarity, as well as some good takeaway messages for our listeners. So I think mission accomplished.
Thank you guys for listening. We love our audience and we love that you continually listen to us. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And send us more things to talk about. If you have something you think that we should discuss or certain words that we blatantly left out of this episode, let us know.
And we're always looking for topics for different episodes or injuries or whatever it is that you might want to learn more about. Thank you so much for joining us today. We hope that it resonated with you and that you learned something. If you enjoyed this podcast, please rate and leave us a review wherever you get your podcasts. It really helps increase our visibility within the platform so that more awesome people like you can find us.
If you'd like to support us further, pretty please. You can visit our Patreon page at patreon.com/morethanmiles. That's www.patreon.com/morethanmiles. Or for a few dollars, you can help the show grow and keep going, as well as receive exclusive perks like monthly Q&As with us. Until next time, remember to run the mile you're in, and that training is so much more than miles.